Hello and welcome back to another video. Today we have something a wee bit different. If you do remember, I said one of my goals is to get our bullet up the top right there and our blitz up to 1,000 rating. Today I've just been blitzing out blitz games. So I've actually played quite a few. We did go on an 8 game win streak. I'm going to show you some of the games from that, and we have today also, I believe it was today, maybe yesterday, beat our highest ever ELO on Blitz, and it's quite a gap now. So it was I have 6 games lined up, and then at the end of it we're gonna have a wee look at the stats and see what position we're standing in at the moment. Some of the games are a lot shorter than others, so stick around and tell me what was your favorite. And yeah, let's just get straight into it. So wrong one, go here. Excuse me. So the first game, it is going up in rating. So the first game here, we are 815. Again, all of these are taken from today. I was hovering around 800 mark, and I've just been blitzing out games, getting them done, and just learning a wee bit. So Scandinavian is definitely something that we're taking off playing, something I am enjoying quite a bit, and I don't have the best win rate with it, so I don't, but I do manage to get decent possessions that I can pull out of. Now this game is an 85.7% accuracy game, so it is quite good. We have played the Scandinavian with black 68 times with a 44% win rate, so 10% off the ideal. I said the ideal is 54%, but you want to be at least winning 50. Here I'm immediately looking to trade off queens. Okay, it's easy, he loses the right to castle, and we can quickly get developed, putting pressure, so he's needing to start getting all his pieces focused around this pawn, and he's already lost the right to castle, so we can use that to our benefit as well. So here my idea, get the fianchetto, add another target there to the pawn. We just say, okay, if he wants to give us a check, we'll trade off the bishops, you know, because we're in the better position, he's lost the right to castle. If we start to trade down the pieces, we're going to end up quite better there. So I'm thinking, okay, we'll start chasing down the bishop. Where does he want to go with it? And he just keeps retreating. So now we have the opportunity to come in, add another attacker. So it's currently 2-on-1. He does defend it with a pawn, which is quite an easy move to see. And here I'm thinking, okay, maybe we can fianchetto, just get castled something. We'll tuck away from him, you know, rub it in his face a wee bit. He does try to start a wee pawn avalanche here. Clearly that we are going to castle, let's say. We do have a few pieces here, so it can get tied up. And the reason I played this pawn move, push the pawn up, now obviously he can take and we'll just lose his bishop, but the whole idea, okay, we'll go here, and at least there's there. So if he, so if we go here, or sorry, let's say he makes a move, then he pushes the pawn, right, and we go here, takes, he comes in, and then, like, you know, not that we get this pawn, but we do have constant pressure there. He is a wee bit better, but anyway, that's not what happened. What ended up happening after I pushed the pawn, he's starting again this pawn avalanche, coming down the board, trying to cramp all our pieces. I'm happy enough, I think, that we can get out of it. Now, castling this side was a choice because of this pawn avalanche. Obviously, now this pawn is up for grabs, that he can just take and open up our position a wee bit. He doesn't take it just yet, but he does take it after kicking our pieces out. And I'm like, okay, we'll just start bringing a king over. Bring king over, and it's quickly under attack. Now, taking the bishop is a miss. Okay, the reason that this is a miss, if I went knight to c5, it is a discovered attack on his bishop that is pinned. If he takes, the knight, we can then go bishop takes c3, taking the knight, and he cannot take back. His rook is under attack. There's not really much. Computer gives bishop d3, so just drop all the way back, cut that pin, and lose the bishop, or lose the rook. Sorry, in the corner. Now we don't see that straight off the bat, but after I do take, he decides to move. Now, here I can take the rook. Okay, we are just up a rook. We have just taken a knight with the bishop, and we can get a rook there as well. What I thought was, okay, well, what if we give him a check? Now, yes, we could have taken the rook, but now he needs to take back. He doesn't need to. But why wouldn't you? Okay, like, this piece is alright, my bishop's already taken two of his pieces. He's like, alright, I need to get something back. Takes the bishop. Now it's a big, big mistake because now there's a discovered attack and we get the bishop as well. So that's, we got three of his pieces for two of ours. Sorry, for one of ours, because we still have our knight, so we do. And his king's just well out in the open, went for a wee walk, and now that we can just start gobbling up all the pawns. Kind of try to keep pressure on his king. Again, it's looking like our pieces are quite tied up. Like our knights were here and here, now they're just two squares over in the same colour complex. Okay, yeah, that was a free pawn, the game with check. But I was like, okay, my idea here is, well, this is now pressured. This square is protected, and so is this square. His knight can't develop out, could be taken, can't come out this way. It's not really ideal, doesn't do much for him. And his king is extremely limited. His king can't go here, 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 or, well, yeah, that's it. His king, you know, is not exactly in a mating net, but not far off it either. So, here we're attacking the pawn, okay? It can be defended with the rook. Or he can come down and he can attack us, okay? And that is what he does. After taking a pawn, trying to open up our king a wee bit, he does come down and attack our knight, but doesn't really do anything because we can take that pawn anyway, and we're now pressuring his other rook, threatening to capture it. He drops back, we give a check. Now, here in this position, computer does give rook takes, and after, what's this, knight? Knight takes here, and then this is up for grabs, but obviously there is a discovered attack there as well, after we move the knight, but he's just in a lost position. He takes the knight, so we take the rook, why wouldn't we, okay, take the rook with the discovered attack from the bishop. After that, we just give him another check. Happily trade down this bishop, this rook for a rook. Why do they keep calling rooks bishops? Trade the rook for the rook, and if he takes on the knight, so say, you know, how would the game continue? Moves up, well, there's a mate in 10, now the mate in 10 is rook d8 check after knight. Let's give him knight d4? Oh, so. Knight d4? What? Okay, so knight d4. Rook takes d4 check, king e3, attacking both of the pieces here. We have rook h3, give another check, king f2, now if he takes here, cuts it down to mate in 3 instead of a mate in 6, I'll show you that quickly, so that'll be take. Rook d3 check, he can't take the bishop because knight protects, and he can't take the knight because the pawn protects. The only move he has here is king c4 after king c4's bishop. D5 check, defended by the rook again. Just all the pieces are just really good harmony. After here, it's rook b3 checkmate. Cut off by the knight, cut off by the bishop, and cut off by the rook all around. And the pawn as well. Pawn gets involved too. So yeah, that was a game that I just resigned after losing loads of material. The opening was a Scandinavian, trading off the queens real quick, putting pressure on the pawn that he's advanced in the center, and kind of basing the attack around that. Once we see his pawn avalanche coming in, we start to reroute our pieces over to the king side, his king side, where we know he's going to be. We trade off one piece for two, managed to get it brilliantly, and then just start to swarm his king right in the middle of the board with not a nice checkmate, because we didn't get the checkmate. But it was definitely there to be played. So, on the next one, now this one, you can see that we 8-16, one rating higher. It's not that these games are obviously played one after each other, but we're going up the rating ladder, so we are. In this one, with black again, we'll go for another Scandinavian, like, happily love Scandinavian. Now, this is something I'm seeing quite often, is the pawn push, and I don't really know what to do about it. I'm not studied it or anything, so I'm like, okay, well, you push, I'm gonna push. Here you have several moves. You can pin the bishop, pin the knight with the bishop, you can bring your knight out, you can defend, possibly even back in this position. You can turn it into something like advanced Caro Kann, a Caro Kann, striking back in the center, which is something I'm starting to do now, but not in this game, it's not something I learned. So it, decided to try, okay, we're going to protect this pawn, throw all our pieces around it. He does overextend on his king side, and he starts to push his pawn, so it's clear that he is going to castle king side. We just got to be able to open up and attack for it. I thought I turned off the bloody, sorry about this, I thought I turned off the best move. There we go. Right. Okay, no, it's still there. Okay. Now, anyway, so we traded down the pawns. We could have brought the queen up, but I thought, okay, we'll put the bishop here. Decide to attack, pin his knight to his rook. But if we did bring the queen up, we would have been doing the same thing and attacking all the pawns around us as well. So game progresses a wee bit. We do jump in, attacking his knight. We do try to open up the lines. So say he takes, takes. He would have to take us here, because if he didn't, it would just be the other way around. So say after takes, he played. Say he went here. We just would have probably taken rook takes. Rook takes. And I just feel better after then we castle. We're in a good position. We are. Again, that is not what happens. What ends up happening is after we push c6, he doesn't take and he starts to throw down his a pawn as well. We're again going to trade down pieces here. Do make a massive blunder because this is now a major threat, but he doesn't see it. We do see it. We could have castled, but I was like, okay, I don't want to castle and commit myself to that side of the board, possibly get into a bit of trouble. Here, you just give up the pawn. And we're going to trade down the queens because I do feel a lot more comfortable. If he took us there again, that would have just benefited us. So that just benefits us. Especially with the pawn structure that we have and how over advanced he is, it'd be quite difficult for him to get back and defend. Now, here I'm pinning the pawn, or pinning the knight to the rook, attacking the pawns also. I shouldn't have taken. Now, it's not that I was low on time, but again, once you see, well, in comparison to him, I am quite low on time. I have 15 seconds left. But once you see that red timer just going, you start to panic. You don't know what is going on. So we really are trying here to get anything that we can. 3 seconds left, he has 45. We end up getting back this rook, so we're on even position. But we do run out of time now. Computer gives white a 0.4 advantage. I would say that's because of the amount of space that white has. And the pawn structure as well. He's clearly going to win this pawn. We could give him a check. Easily blocked. So that did knock us down a peg. Knocked us back a wee bit. But nothing drastic, so it wasn't. And he was an 800 opponent rated. 800 rated opponent. Now, this is the game that we ended up playing, the highest rating ever that we have played on Blitz, and oh my god, I don't know how I came up against this guy, or what chess.com was actually trying to do to me here. But our opponent, it's 1,180 rated. Now, that may not seem really, really drastic to any of you, but whenever you are 851 Blitz rated player, like, that's 300 plus points, 329 points, if I'm not wrong. How have we come up against him? Chess.com, explain to me here. Why has this happened? But we go back to, again, I don't want to overdo it. I don't want to, recently I've been playing D4 and C4, so I have our, you know, transitioning into quite a lot of different things, but I was like, okay, well, we're going to go back to our roots and play the Vienna, so we are, and I was happy that I did, because we got this move, and oh my god, I loved whenever this move came in, because now we can play F4 and immediately go for the good classic Vienna. It does allow it to happen, which is just brilliant, you know. See, whenever I get this, oh, it's the nicest feeling ever. Now, he blocks with his queen. Is not an ideal move, but it's understandable as it does pin our pawn to our king, so we can't take his knight. Okay, we do the same. So this is the move. This is the line. It's theory that I have learnt the degree from Gotham Chess's Chess League, the free course. So once the knight draws back, you need to bring your knight out and stop this check from happening. We then start throwing our pawns up in the centre. We have a very strong, lovely centre here, defended by the bishops out, the knights are out. We just need our last bishop out, and we can castle easily this way. A few moves, and we can castle kingside as well, just adding even more pressure. It's clear, and it is quite evident, that he does want to castle kingside, because it'll take him a lot less moves than it would for him to go queenside. Okay? And here he did make a mistake. Now, why is it a mistake? Because we can jump in with a knight attacking his queen, taking it off the eyes of our pawn. So that then gives us the ability to take his pawn with a discovered check. Why would you not? I don't know. I castled. I don't know why I didn't, but it just castled. So he blocks it with his knight. Now he has a chance to castle. We give him a check. After takes, takes, his knight is pinned. The pawn is attacking the knight as well. And quickly add, you know, more attackers, even get the knight in there as well. We take the pawn, and he takes back. Again, just repinning his other knight, and we add another attacker to the second knight with our dark square bishop, still pinned. And now we can happily trade off. Shouldn't have given the bishop up for the knight, but he's now lost the right to castle. It's going to be a lot more difficult for him, and that is quite a strong thing. Whenever you lose the right to castle, it's difficult to come back against. So after a check, he pins himself again. And yeah, there you go. We just, there was pin with a knight on the first move. So let's go back. After he pinned his first knight, okay, it's attacked by two pieces. The pawn and the queen. We take. He then pins his other knight. We attack it again. So put pressure on the pinned piece. And that's exactly what we do three times in a row. There we go. Put pressure on the pinned piece. Now that's just a bishop for us. There's nothing he can do to save that bishop, and he resigns in this position. And we beat the highest rating that we have beat on Blitz, 1180 rated, as an 850 rated. I don't know why I came up against him. Someone make it make sense, please. I don't know how many points I actually gained off that game. I would assume probably 11, I think, is the highest. 11 or 12 is the highest that you can get. As you can see, 851. Now, on to the next game. We are now 865. So there was quite a lot of games there. We did go on that 8 game win streak. And I believe that's just one from it. Yes, actually, I think it's a slap bang in the middle. Now, is this one of the overly long games? It's not an overly long game, but there's a massive, massive attack that we put onto our opponent, and it was lovely. So, back to the Vienna. Why not? But I do see very quickly. Alright, he's going for a Karo Khan. And I think, what do I hate coming up against whenever I've done the Karo Khan? I hate coming up against the Fantasy. So that's exactly what we'll do. We'll do the Fantasy. And you see, 3 seconds for currently 4 moves in the game. Now we can happily develop as normal, pressure his pieces that he's bringing out. In this position, I probably should have, excuse me, dropped the bishop back or something, but didn't. I brought the queen up. When I brought the queen up, again, it's defending everything. Possibly attacks going here. Obviously, he has 2 pieces, so I don't want that just yet. But we're starting to get the bishop out. We can castle kingside. 2 more moves, and we can castle queenside as well. Here, very simple idea is just to go for, not checkmate because he can escape this way, but just to go for an attack, okay? Now, he can't easily be blocked, which he does do. We just drop the queen back 1 square. We don't want to drop it back too far because then it just takes it out of the game, takes it out of the attack. And yeah, this move, I don't really understand. Probably just, you know, solidify the center a wee bit more. And here I'm just meeting, okay, we're just going to start pushing the pawn, bring it up to his king, get traded, open up his king a bit. Can't be taken because it's defended twice and it's only attacked twice. So he can't take the pawn. So we push, he takes, so it is a miss. Now, it says it's a miss because now that we can just get our knight out, nothing's happening. This pawn's under attack, possibly get the queen in and stuff. But what ends up happening? We take. Slides up his rook, possibly, you know, to try to get his king out and get the safety, also to attack this pawn, but that's not going to cut it. We do develop our knight just to make sure that we have a possibility to castle and nothing's going on there, and to double up the rooks as well as the idea. So we drop the bishop back. It says it is a mistake. Now it's an only a mistake if he plays bishop e8 attacking the rook. We play rook h6, bishop f7, castles, knight d7, king b1, b5. You know, this big long sequence of chess, stockfish, has come out with. But, you know, he's a human, he's not going to see all that, so he's not. So, here in this position, we take with the rook. Okay, we don't take with the queen, because we want our queen here, and then we want to go for this. This is what we want. We don't want to drop the queen back, and this, again, defends this pawn as well, freeing up our bishop to come up as well. So, we bring the, push the pawn. Now, we push the pawn to, you know, help open up the rook, that we can pin to his rook, let's pin to his king. So if he takes our pawn, we can take the rook, he needs to take this king, then we can start getting checks and stuff in, trade down pieces. Now it is a miss because he can take in this position, he actually can take he can't. It's a miss because of queen e7, apparently. I don't know, that's not what happened. We push the rook, he brings out his bishop, I'm going to get that bishop traded off, so trade off the bishop. Now here you may be enticed to take with the pawn, but very, very strangely, kind of brilliant move, we're taking with the queen. Now why do I get a brilliant move for taking with the queen? Because, you know, this rook can be taken. Okay, well what happens if that rook's taken? Well, our queen gets in then, and you know, it is also pinned. And what happens? Knight d5. Computer does say that he should have taken the rook. After this, we would have went queen h7 check, king f8 the only move, rook f6, and then it's saying he needs to sack the queen or else it's a mate in one. So he needs to take, and we take, and then, you know, he's lost, he's not winning this. If he doesn't take the rook and instead he goes king e8, it's just checkmate. That is not checkmate, it's queen f7 is checkmate. So it is completely cut off, can't be taken. Again, the sequence changes a wee bit. He doesn't take and he goes knight here instead. We just sack the rook. Because after we sack the rook, we take with the queen. Queen's defended, defend the rook, forces him back, give him a check. Now, there is a more efficient way of doing that there of... after he goes here, we could have went rook g6 again. Same kind of sequences before, but we decide to do it this way. He couldn't have went there. He's just completely cut off. We get a lovely checkmate on the back rank. Just all from a massive attack that we started to throw at his pieces. And a very, very strange, brilliant move from taking the light square bishop with the queen instead of the pawn. It is quite a weird straight like this side. I don't know why that got two exclamation marks. Very, very strange one. Sacking the rook and just going for an all-out attack. So that was one of our, you know, one of the games I felt quite good about, so I did. So next on the agenda, we have a very, very quick game, a 94% accuracy game. This was just, again, like the previous, but with black, it's just attack, 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 and the opponents just get confused. Now, obviously, at this level, they're going to get confused. We are 879 rated in this point in time. Scandinavian again, brilliant, easy, we're comfortable with these moves. I do decide to go for something different that I haven't tried before. Usually I would go bishop e7 and kingside castle, especially after he brings the bishop out. I would open up the c-file, the diagonal here, to get the queen out. But I'd say, okay, we're going to bring the bishop out this time. So we take, he's going to take with his bishop, and you know, we'll see how that position ends up. That is what happens. First we castle, we take, he tries to attack our queen. Here we have got queen a3. But I decide to go for queen a4, because after takes, we have bishop takes. He just resigns. I'm like, okay, I have a 2.1 advantage. It's nothing major. Computer does give queen going here and sacking your rook. Now, we don't really have a lot of escape squares here for our queen, but he is a rook down, okay? We are obviously a lot safer in this position. but they're resigning in that position. I just find it quite strange. Now, the reason that queen here is better because computer gives if he takes, we've got queen c3, we just take back, and we're just in his position, attacking all his pawns. And his bishop as well. He can't save it all, so he can't save for bishop. Yep, bishop back. We go bishop takes g4. End up. Oh no, sorry, that's not g4. What am I doing? Bishop g4. Pinning the knight, so we can go take and trade down, destroy this pawn structure. Yeah, I did not understand why he resigned so early. Yeah, okay, you're losing a rook, that's fine. But yeah, resigning in this position, to me, was a bit crazy. But yeah, that is what happened. Now, 879 rated we were in that game. Currently, in this game, we are 886 rated. This is another decent game. Nothing special, I don't think, happened in this game. It was a long fought game, I believe. Yeah, this is a long game, so it is. But we'll fly through it, so it will. Now, in this one, we do end up going for, again, Vienna game is what we're going for, but he does go for the French defense. I was happy to do this position because his, you know, his queen isn't here to open up and, oh, didn't mean to do that, what did I do? Okay, so yeah, he trades his bishop for our knight. He's pushing his pawns quite a lot, maybe overextending a bit much. We castle, get ourselves to safety. We don't need to worry about destroying a pawn structure because protected by the queen. So yeah, we'll happily take the bishop pair. Now we just jump into this position. He's overextended. We don't have any pawns that can get us kicked out. And yeah, I'm happy with him. Like, yeah, let's go. He does decide to attack us with a knight. Just drop back one score, okay? If he wants to take, we can take with the queen. We can take with the pawn. But he doesn't do that, and he decides to attack with a pawn again. Excuse me. And here in this position, we have just got queen takes. I don't go for queen takes. I get a wee bit worried about my bishop link. I want to keep it. So we do keep the bishop. Obviously, I could have my queen here. And then computer gives knight. What? G6? Jumping in here? No? What? Hold on, what's computer get? Oh, sorry. Knight G6 and jumping on the F file. And then we go queen takes. No. Queen takes queen. And then he loses the right to castle, or else he takes with the rook. And then obviously we can just take like this. Attacking his rook, adding pressure. That's not what happens. I get a wee bit worried. I decide to keep my bishop. And I'm kind of glad I did. It does become quite vital. Because now we take. After he takes, his pawn structure has the g-file open now. And his pawns are just ridiculously overextended. I'm happy to trade down everything in this position because I just don't feel that he's going to be able to keep safe. He's not going to keep himself protected. There's a big battle going on here in the D-file at the minute. I do think that we are winning that battle. He's got 1, 2, 3. Well, we have 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we're winning that trade if something does happen. I take, he takes back, we give him a check. Now we remove one of the attackers off that square. We give him a check, he blocks his queen. Happily, trade down, not a problem. Drop the bishop back. After we drop the bishop back, we give him a check. Now the reason to give him a check is to take him away from the center of the board. Because if he's out here with the open g-file, all his pawns, kind of a lot more cramped on this side, on his king side, than it is at the opposite. So, we take. He decides not to take our rook, so we're okay, snap up that rook. Because if he takes back, we're just up a rook. Very, very simple. Now it's just about clearing down the rest of his pawns and getting promoted. Didn't do it in the most efficient way, definitely not. Give him a bunch of checks, trading down the pawns at the right time. We do decide to trade off the bishop for quite an advanced pawn of his. And yeah, we just start getting pushed, and he gives up his knight, and it's a very, very simple ladder checkmate here. So that was one of, again, that was six of our games that we did play today. I've just been sitting here playing, not recording, not streaming or anything. And we're going to have a look at the stats now. Again, I still can't believe we came up against a 1,180 rated player. Really can't believe that. So we're going to have a wee look at the stats, switch over scenes here. So this is of all time. Today, our highest we reached was 912. Currently, we set at 903. As I said, the goal is to get to 1,000. So I think we're definitely on track. In the last 7 days, we've gained 95 ELO, nearly 100, which I think a week, 100 a week, that's really, really good, but I'm not going to keep up with that pace. And yeah, our, it says here our average opponent rating is 5.11, but in the last 7 days, our average is 8.26. It changes. And yeah, our strongest win was against that 1,180. Highest win streak was 11. We've got very close to that today. I did go on an 8-game win streak today. Let's see if I can show you the wee results there. So this is, where is it? Starts here. So from here up is all today's game. Start off with 2 wins, lost 1, won 1, lost 2, won 2, lost, draw. 1, draw, draw. Okay, so not too bad, not losing too many in comparison. And then we went on this streak, win. Oh, it was brilliant. And again, we're not plateauing here. There's another 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 streak there without a loss. We're doing quite good here in bullet. Now, these are only 3-minute games. I'm not playing with increment or anything. I'm deciding, okay, we'll keep it kind of simple, get used to the time control. And I am losing on time quite a bit. And it's from winning positions in some of them. And I shouldn't be. But, that's part of the game. It's something I need to get used to. Something I need to, kind of work on. But anyway, guys, that has been my most recent Blitz journey going on. I do hope you enjoyed this type of content. Again, these games are played offline. I'm not playing them on stream or anything. If you would like to actually see me playing these games, come to the live streams. Or if you would like me to just play these games on record without live streaming or anything, and I can talk a wee bit more about the moves without being distracted, let me know. We'll do that there. But yeah, hope you have enjoyed. Have a good one, guys.